Here's one, but it's got something on it.
That's my song.
That's Christmas Play, so I've been
Christmas Play?
There you go. Boy, taking notes or something? You need a napkin, brother? Me too. I got them in my file at work. I got napkins, I guarantee. I appreciate everybody coming out and being with us. I know it's, I haven't figured out which week was 4th of July week. Can somebody figure that out for me? I don't know if it was last week or this week because of the day it fell on. But regardless, I appreciate you coming out tonight. And we'll just say we're the ones that didn't have enough money to go off nowhere. How's that? That's what we'll say. But we got Jesus, don't we? So I think we'll be all right. But I appreciate you coming out and being with us tonight. And good to have some folks that back that haven't been able to be here on Wednesday. Now, I'd be glad when this old COVID, coronavirus, whatever, all this thing, it's got so many names. I'll be glad when this is all over, won't you? And I think it will be. We just got to keep praying and keep seeking God's face on it. And we'll get rid of this thing. So, but I do appreciate you coming out and being with us in service tonight. I might as well go ahead and we'll go, Lord. Now, I think if I heard correctly, Jeff's going to be singing at a funeral tomorrow, and I'm going to assume that was Teresa and Rachel and Karen and all of there. So let's remember that family when we pray that God will. And if you're
Charles is preaching it.
Yeah. Sure. Yep. Always sad. So, Rachel and Teresa and Karen and a whole lot of you, if you're listening in tonight on Facebook, we love you and we're praying for you. And we're just going to ask God's grace and peace to be right there with you. So, I think we're on Facebook. I guess it's already started, but at any rate. Yes, we hate that that happened, but we're going to be a praying. So anyway, that's one prayer request. We'll take others here in a minute. I think I'm going to go ahead, though. I got a couple of jokes. I found me some new jokes, all right? And I'm so happy. I was laughing myself today. I told me the joke, and I laughed at it. That's pretty good, ain't it, when you get there. But they're horse jokes. I never knew there was such thing as horse jokes. And what do you do? All right, when you're on a horse riding full blast and a giraffe comes charging up next to you, and then all of a sudden you realize you got a lion nipping at your heels, get off the carousel and sober up. That's what you do. I thought that was pretty funny, you know. I did. I had another one. I'll think of it in a little bit. But at any rate, how many folks has got a prayer request tonight? Everybody? I bet there's some folks didn't even raise their hand and you got prayer requests. But let's, anybody anything real special you want to share with us before we start tonight? Anything real special? All right. Well, let's just go ahead and go to the Lord in prayer. And I'm going to ask you to do this. Me and Claire were talking a while ago, and she said she's been praying hard for this service tonight, been praying for the anointing to be on this service tonight. And let's pray that God, let's not ever get so, I guess, far from being spiritual. I don't really know how to put it. But let's don't ever get so far that we think we can have church without the Holy Spirit of God. Yeah. Got to have Him. He's got to move. If He doesn't move, we just wasted our time. Amen. So let's pray. Let's pray that He'll anoint these singers. And they got guitar. We don't have the piano tonight, but they got guitar. Let's just ask that He anoint every part of this service tonight, all right? And we'll just go ahead and go to the Lord in prayer. Jason, if you don't mind, I'm going to ask you to lead us in prayer, all right? Father, we thank You tonight for the privilege of being able to be in Your house tonight. God, I ask that You would have Your way in this service. God, we've got so many prayer requests. God, lots of hands went up tonight. And we know they didn't just raise them just to be raised. And we know there's legitimate needs and desires and requests behind all of those. And God, we just pray that You'll have Your way in every single one of them. Lord, we do as we mentioned a while ago, God, we ask that you anoint the service tonight. This whole church, God, everybody, the listeners as well as the ones that are performing in the service tonight or doing anything in this service, we ask, God, that you'll anoint them with the Holy Ghost. And Lord, we'll thank you and we'll praise you for every single thing that you do. We'll give you the glory for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 All right. Let's do it.
Amen. Do something different tonight. Mark, if you can pull up just the lyrics to Waymaker. We're just going to sing verse and chorus of that, because I just want you to listen to the words. Sometimes we get lost in the music and the track and the arrangement and the how big it is and how powerful it is. But I like to make it simple tonight, and I want everyone to stand and sing these lyrics with us. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship you. Sing. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Sing that again. Yeah. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every darkness, my God, that is who you are. Yeah, Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. I'm glad he's a Waymaker. Amen. I've been working, obviously the choir knows that I've been working on that song today. And I love that song. Love Lifted Me, page 265. NG, Phil. Love Lifted lift, love them. Yep. Hope I can sing it better than I can say it. Love Lifted Me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Very deeply stained within, seeking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now say, am I. Love lifted me. Thanks. Y'all know how to pause there at the end. Y'all raised in some church, wouldn't you? Yeah. All right. Last verse, I guess. That's about all I can do. Souls in danger, look above. Jesus completely saves. He will lift you by his love out of the angry wave. He's the master of the sea. Billows his will obey. He your Savior wants to be. Be saved today. Oh, lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me.
Got it, Mark? There we go. Good to be in the Lord's house tonight, amen. Good to see your smiling face tonight, too. I've said it before, every song we ever do is all about him. It don't matter what song we sing. If it's something, if it's lifting him and praising him, that's why we sing it, okay? We just want to make that perfectly clear right up front, all right? Looking forward to the message tonight from Brother David. Again, good to see you and good to be here. There ain't nothing that can't be done by me and God. Ain't nobody gonna come between me and God. One day we'll live together where angels trod, me and God. Early in the morning talking it over, me and God. Late at night talking it over, me and God. You could say we're like two peas in a pod, me and God. He's my father, he's my friend, the beginning and the end. He rules the world with a staff and rod, and we're team. Me and God. I am weak, but he is strong. Me and God. And he forgives me when I'm wrong. Me and God. He's the one I lean on when life gets hard. Me and God. He's my father, he's my friend, the beginning and the end. He rules the world with a staff and rod, and we're teams, me and God. He's my father, he's my friend, the beginning and the end. He rules the world with the staff and rod, and we're a team, me and God, and we're a team, me and God. I've got a house that keeps me warm, and it shelters me from storm. Yes, I am one blessed man. I've got a wife who holds me tight and who prays for me at night. Yes, I am one blessed man. These are a few of the blessings that I have known. If I had time, I could go on and on. Well, my children are great kids. I don't know what I ever did to be what I am. One blessed man. I've got Jesus in my heart, and he never will depart. Yes, I am one blessed man. Sing it if you know it. These are a few of the blessings that I have known. If I had time, I could go on and if someone says to you, who's that man, what does he do? Just tell them I am a one blessed man. You can tell them I am. Thank God I'm one blessed man.
I appreciate that. I really do. I appreciate the singers. I'm telling you, and all the ones that come and they prepare to get the singing going, and Mark back there running the sound. This thing wouldn't be nearly as good without them. And we're thankful every service we have for these people. Mark sits behind the wall back there and minds his business. And, I say behind the wall. He's actually got a little throne back there, if you'll notice. I mean, it's more kingly than it is. We ain't got him hid. There ain't no doubt about that. But we appreciate him. Turn with me to Acts chapter number 27, and I thought of my other horse joke while I was sitting. I forgot it a while ago, but what do you call an Amish guy? And I had to clean this up a little bit, but what do you call an Amish guy with his hand down a horse's mouth? A mechanic. Hey, I like it anyway. All right, I think it's good anyway. I got another one, but I didn't have time to clean it up. I'll get that one next week, all right? But turn with me to Acts chapter number 27. Some of you look like, I don't get that. I don't get it. Come on, man. You get that, surely, right? Amish, they don't have, okay, all right. But anyway, Acts chapter 27. We're going to read just a few verses. We're going to read verse number 14, and then we'll read 20 through 25. I didn't want to read all of them. I think most of you know this story. I think I've preached on this same story three or four times. But tonight, We're going to preach. I started a series last week on the subject, I Believe God.
Amen.
And this is where we take our text from, out of this chapter. And this is a good story right here. I mean, there's a lot of, I think everything is put in the Bible for us to read, relate to, learn from. And I don't think there's one word that God left out or put in that he didn't have a reason for. That's how I feel about it. And so even in the stories, when you read the stories, you realize things about God and how he can work in your life and things that he can do for you that he done for those in the story. It's basically kind of like a testimony at church. When you hear somebody get up and testify, even though it's not directly thou shalt and thou shalt not, when you read it, it's kind of like a testimony. It's like somebody getting up at church and getting a microphone and saying, let me tell you what God done for me this week. And so Luke's sharing a story with us here in the book of Acts. And he's along with Paul. And Paul is on his way. And before I get too deep, because I'm going to forget here in a minute, me and Charles talk about it sometimes. You got all kinds of cool things to say when you get up here. And then you look out at y'all and it makes you nervous and you forget about half of them, don't you, Charles? That's the way it works. He's been doing it a long time. It still works the same way. Jason, I bet works with you that way, doesn't it, brother? But tonight, in I Believe God, we're going to talk. We've been talking about, we're going to talk for a few weeks on the subject of faith. All right? On the subject of faith. And I hope I can say something that'll help you tonight. And maybe you're here tonight. I think probably all of us here tonight are saved. And so you've already had faith enough to be saved. But I want to talk to you about faith after you're born again tonight. Amen. I want to talk to you about faith when the storm comes, all right? And so storms, the storms of life, and then this week I'm going to preach on the storms that we face, and then next week I'm going to preach on salvation by grace. And then the next week, I'm going to preach about our eternal place. So anyway, I've done it up like Charles likes it done. That's what I'm going to preach on. All right, he wants it to rhyme or have the same letter, or else you're not called to preach. It thundered, and you thought it was God. I think that's the way that works. But at any rate, we're going to try to preach this week on the storms that we face. Storms of life come to all of us, and they're quite often unavoidable and unpreventable. Now, sometimes they are avoidable and they are preventable. There are certain things that you can do that bring about storms in your life. I can just tell you, if you drink a gallon of whiskey a day, one day you're going to have to deal with your liver issues. There ain't no doubt about that. You're going to have problems. If you get out and break the law, you're going to have legal issues. You're going to wind up going to jail. And those are things that we bring on ourselves. If you don't keep your car serviced, we'll break it down a little bit. If you don't keep your car serviced ever, they'll lead you to believe it's 3,500 miles. Somebody over at the oil well wrote that manual. They want you to get that stuff changed so they can charge you for it. But if you don't keep that thing changed about every 5,000 miles or so, eventually you're going to have problems with it, all right? So we do bring some of it. Some of our storms are preventable. We bring some of it, and this I speak from firsthand experience. I brought some of them on myself, all right? I'm glad God's good enough, though, all right, when you do bring some of them on yourself. I'm glad that he's good enough that when you say, you know what, Lord, when you confess your faults, I'm glad that he's a good enough God that he'll even bail you out some of the self-created messes that you get in if you'll get humble and you'll seek his face. He'll do that. There's several ways that we cause a lot of our own troubles. If you spend more than you make, if you get too far out in debt, I'm telling you, that's going to cause you issues. You'll wind up in a bankruptcy court somewhere, and it'll cause you all kinds of stress. And so I'm not trying to be mean or anything tonight, but I'm saying a lot of times we're crying those crocodile tears, and we brought it on ourselves. But I'm glad God's a good God tonight, aren't you? I'm glad He's a forgiving God. But those aren't really the storms that we want to try to talk about tonight. But like I said, storms are quite often unavoidable and unpreventable. And in these times, faith is essential. Faith is necessary. The enemy would have us to believe that all hope is lost when the storms come through our life. If you've ever been there, now I ain't had none in a while. I'm just going to have to be honest. I ain't had no big ones in a while. But son, I've had some, and I know what the enemy whispers in your ear when you think nobody else is around and you think God ain't even listening. The enemy whispers in your ear that there's no hope. You'll never get out of this situation, whatever it is. But God has promised us that we'll make it through. We must choose not only what we believe tonight, but we got to choose in whom we believe. I don't think we ought to believe the devil's lies. And we'll get into this in a little bit. I ain't even read the scripture yet. But let me just read one verse, all right? Let me find the right verse. I'll just read one and we'll get started. Verse number 25. Wherefore, sirs, be of good cheer, for I believe God. Do you hear that? That profound word, I believe God. That's what Paul said. For I believe God that it shall be even as it was told me. And so that hence comes the series tonight of I believe God. So we don't only have to choose what we're going to believe, and I think it's important to know what we believe. I believe we need to know if we're a pig or a possum. I believe that with all my heart. If you don't read your Bible and study a little bit for yourself. You can't just take everybody's word for it. I encourage you to get that book out every once in a while and read it for yourself. In fact, if you'll get that book out every once in a while and read it for yourself, it'll build your faith. That's what this word will do for you. You'll read the stories of where God's come through, and it'll increase, it'll build your faith. And so tonight, I believe we got to know what we believe, but I believe it's more important to know in whom we believe. Paul rightly said in 2 Timothy chapter number 2 and verse number 12, for I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. I can say tonight, Paul knew in whom he believed. And I think if we're going to have a role model, I often say this, in the New Testament, I think Paul is only second to Jesus as the most powerful figure in the New Testament. Man, he had faith, you know. He believed that God can move mountains. He believed all of those things, and he trusted God on a daily basis. Today, faith seems to be, and I'll say this, we do live in dark times today, but faith seems to be at an all-time low. Can I go on the record tonight as saying that the devil is a liar. Amen? That felt pretty good. I believe I'll say it again. The devil today is a liar. And whatever you're going through, that he's telling you that you're not going to make it through, bless God, he's a liar tonight, and he don't know what he's talking about. In fact, that's why the scripture says that he's the father of a lie. You know what the father is, don't you? The father is the one that gave birth to the lie. Well, actually, the mother would, but the father's got something to do with it. That's not a conversation for in here, but at any rate, the Bible calls him the father of a lie. You know why that is, don't you? Now, I'll tell you this tonight. I'll give you some of the biggest lies I've ever heard in my life, and then I'll explain to you why the scripture calls him the father of a lie. He is a liar, proclaims the scripture. But one of the biggest lies you'll ever hear And this is why he's called the father of a lie. In Genesis chapter number 2, in the book of Genesis, God commanded Adam and Eve not to eat of any. He said, you can eat of any other tree in the garden, but if you eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt surely die. Now, so in Genesis chapter number 3, the devil comes along. The Bible says he's a serpent, and he subtly comes along and he tells Eve this. This is one of the first lies. He said, it's been said that you're not allowed to eat of any of the trees in the garden. Now, listen, he don't even know what he's talking about to start with, because that ain't what God said. God didn't say you couldn't eat out of any of the trees. And Eve corrected him. She said, no, we can eat of every tree in the garden. But God said, if we eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, then we'll surely die. Now, listen to what he says. He says, thou shalt not surely die. That's the first lie. I believe you could go back and get testimony from Adam and Eve. They didn't die a physical death, but they died a spiritual death that day in the Garden of Eden. So he's a liar today. And whatever he says to you in your times of joy or in your times of trouble, he's a liar today. Absolutely. He's got a lie for every situation that you might be in. So one of the biggest lies I've ever heard is, thou shalt not surely die. The devil started that mess. The second one is, you're not being arrested, you're just being detained. And that's a lie, all right? If they ever put your hands behind your back and slap them cuffs on you and tell you that, mark her down, they're just like the devil. You're going to jail, brother. Ain't no doubt about it. I don't care what they say. They need to sign off on that. That's all I can say. Don't ask me how I know all that. But at any rate, and the third biggest lie, and you can listen to the mainstream media anytime, any day or night, and you'll hear the rest of the biggest lies that you've ever heard. What's going on in America right now is probably about 40% truth and 60% political, and they just keep it stirred up, all right? They just keep the pot rolling, keep us all. I'll get into that in a little bit, but not too deep. I don't want to hurt nobody's feelings tonight out there in Facebook land. We used to call it radio land. I don't want to hurt nobody's feelings tonight, but I will tell you this tonight. I am sick and tired. I said this to something to this effect last week, but I am sick and tired of that low down, good for nothing, egg sucking, cross-eyed dog the devil causing us to run around scared to death every day of our lives. I'm going to tell you something. We got a big old God. He's plenty able to take care of us tonight, and we need to start believing him again that he is well able to take care of us. You say, well, you're just a crazy preacher. You don't believe the data and the science. I do believe the data and the science. I most certainly do. I did pretty good on the data in science. I told them last week I did pretty good in school on that. I believe in that. But you know what I believe more? I believe God's in control of this entire universe. I believe there ain't nothing ever happened God didn't know about. I believe ain't nothing ever going to happen that God don't know about. I know whom I believe, not just what I believe tonight. Lord, I got to calm down. Claire said she's prayed that the anointing would get on me. I believe she did. Amen. But at any rate, I got to get into the message. I got to hurry up. Let me get my clock out. I done forgot to look. That time don't count if I didn't know what time it was, right? Number one, we're going to take a look at this situation. What's going on here? And I didn't read all the verses, so I'm just going to paraphrase it. As you well know, Paul is on a journey here. Now, it's not a good journey. He's not on a cruise. He's not on the carnival magic here. He wishes he was. We probably all wish we were right now. But I bet it's very different now, don't you? I mean, I bet it's very, very different. Well, I don't even think they can cruise yet. But when they do go back to cruising, you'll have to wear probably a bodysuit and have both your fingers stuck up your nose and one in your ear. You ain't going to be able to touch nobody. It's going to be terrible, I could imagine. But at any rate, Paul was on a journey here. And his journey wasn't a good journey. We're going to, first of all, tonight, look at the ferocity of the storm. He's on a journey, and I'll say this. He was in a storm before the storm ever hit. He's on his way to Rome to stand before Caesar,
he's gotten in trouble again. Paul was a troublemaker too, by the way. He would not stop preaching on Jesus. He wouldn't shut up. And so he had stood before Felix. He had stood before Festus. Every time I hear that, I think of gun smoke, and you do too. But at any rate, he had stood before all of them. And finally, they kind of washed their hands out of it. And he appealed to them that he should go and stand before Caesar in Rome. So Agrippa, and in fact, at the end of chapter number 26, if he wouldn't have made that appeal, he'd have been set free right then. Don't you know, he thought later, what was I thinking? I should have just let it go. But at any rate, he was going to stand before Caesar. He jumped on a ship, 275 other people with him, and he jumped on a ship and he's headed there. But before he can ever get there, a terrible storm breaks out. And so we're going to first of all look at the ferocity, or how ferocious the storm was. In verse number 14, I will go back and read that. But not long after, there arose against it a tempestuous wind called Euroclydon. That's the storm. Euroclydon, that name is somewhere between a monsoon and a hurricane. I mean, it's a bad storm. It ain't some little pop-up thunderstorm that like we've had a lot of lately. It's not that kind of deal, some little summertime deal. And some of our storms are like that. You know, the washing machine breaks. The car tears up. I got my truck air conditioner don't work anymore. It quit working a few weeks back. I didn't realize it was hot outside till that thing quit working. But you know, it's warm out there. And I want to get it fixed. I hadn't took it to get it fixed yet because I'm afraid. I've heard all the horror stories about how much it costs to get a compressor put on one. And I'm afraid that's what, so I just have left it sitting in the barn shed. But I'm going to have to eventually take that thing up there and let somebody take a look at it. But that's a little old pop-up thing. That ain't something tragic and something that's going to change the course of my life. I'm a fat boy. It might even make me lose some weight. But it's not going to change a whole lot about my life. Maybe you just have a bad day at work every once in a while, and you know, on and on and on, etc. But that wasn't what kind of storm this was, and that ain't what I want to talk to you about tonight. I want to talk to you about those real storms in your life, those things that come through that the devil looks you in the eye and says, you'll never make it. You'll never get through this one. I still got news for him. I've been through several of them, and you know what? I'm still here, brother. The devil ain't got me yet. I'm still here. So tonight, it just proves that he's a liar. But that's the storms I want to talk to you about tonight. Those really tough storms that come into your life. You say, preacher, but my life's good. And I'm glad it is. We ought to rejoice God in those days. I mean, those are the times when you just rejoice and say, boy, I'm glad it's this way. But there's coming a time. There's coming a time. We're all going to go through it. In fact, our country's going through it right now. I mean, you can see the difference in people. You know, we didn't know we had it made, really, until just a few months ago. We didn't know how made we really had it. And now things have changed dramatically. The country itself is going through, and it's got two or three storms going at one time. You got two or three of them going at one time. You got the deal with the COVID. You got the thing with all the protests aren't bad, but all that destruction ain't right tonight. I mean, they need to lock them up and throw away the key, brother. I'll just go ahead and say it. I'm just going to let it rip tonight. I'll say what I believe. It's okay for you to go out if you don't believe something. It's okay for you to go out and peacefully protest. Our Constitution gives us the right to do that. I believe even God would give us the right to do that. But when you go to destroying people's property and tearing down their businesses, something needs to be done, and these lily-livered liberals need to get back off and let somebody do something about it. So there you are. Anyway, that was good enough. That's as mean as I'm going to get tonight, all right? But we're going to look at the ferocity of the storm tonight. Lord, that made me mad enough to preach here. It just ruffles my dander tonight to be able to see all that mess. Oh, Lord. Minneapolis is going to have a summer of love. That's what she said. See what that turned into, don't you? That's the way the whole world will be if we don't do the right thing here in a few months. I got to get off of that. But at any rate, first thing I want you to know is in verse number 20. Let's look at this real quick. And when neither sun nor stars in many days appear, no small tempest lay on us, all hope that we should be saved was then taken away. You know what? The first thing I want us to notice here is that in this terrible storm, they were disoriented. Yep. Now, you see, back then, they didn't have all the navigational, technical, I don't know what we'd do if we didn't have GPS. I wouldn't ever find my way to nowhere if I didn't have a GPS anymore. Do they even still sell a Rand McNally road map? Can you get them even at a truck stop? I ain't seen one in a long time. I loved them things. They was that big, they wouldn't fit in no compartment in your car, but brother, you could open them up and find your way to anywhere on the globe, man. You could get there. But if we didn't have a GPS, we were lost. These people didn't have the enjoy the convenience of all the modern navigational equipment. They relied on the sun and the stars to get to where they were going. So imagine, this storm's been rolling on for day after day. In fact, the verse says, and when neither sun nor stars in many days appeared. What I'm saying in that, this wasn't just some little old storm. This was a sustained storm, and it was going to hang around for a little while. Now, what I'm going to try to get us to do tonight is be ready for when that happens. I want our faith in God to be strong enough that we can navigate through those times in life. See, you never know when it's going to hit. You never know when all the good news is going to turn into bad news. You never know when one trip to the doctor, one text message, one email, one phone call, one Twitter or whatever it is. You never know when that's going to bring bad news, something that's going to change your life forever. And I tell you, you better have hope in something other than this world when that happens. You better have something beyond what you can see, touch, feel, and hear, and all. You better have some kind of faith when that happens. Amen. But at any rate, they were disoriented. They just felt lost. Now, some of you have been through things. I would be willing to say we got some people that have, maybe, I don't know, I certainly know we have on Sunday mornings around here, have some people, and probably somebody listening in tonight that has recovered from a sickness that the doctor said you'd never recover from. Amen. Amen. You know why? Because the doctor don't have the final say. Amen. He can diagnose you. I mean, he can tell you what you got, but he can't put you in the grave. Amen. He ain't got the final say tonight. That still belongs to the ones that said it is appointed once unto men to die. And only he has that planner. Only he has that calendar. Only he has that. But there's probably some people that have come pulled out of financial situations that the devil looked at you and said, you'll never do it. But I'm telling you tonight, these people felt disoriented. Maybe during that time at some point, and we're all human, maybe we just felt lost, and they didn't know where they were or even where they were headed. And let me tell you something tonight. If you're not real careful tonight, the devil will use those times in your life when you're disoriented to get your focus off of God and get it on the gales. On the wind. He'll take your focus off of God and put it on the storm. And you'll be driving. You know, the captain of the ship done said, just let her ride. Ain't nothing I can do with it. Ted done lost. And that's what'll happen. They were disoriented. They didn't know where they were going, where they were at, or nothing. Don't let the devil get you like that. Just keep your trust in him. They were disoriented. No, they disoriented. I got to hurry through this thing. I got to get to the end of it. But they were discouraged. Look at the last part of verse number 20. It says, and all hope that we should be saved was then taken away. Isn't that a terrible place to be? I mean, if we didn't have hope, I mean, what in the world would we do if we didn't think there could possibly be a brighter day tomorrow? I mean, that's depressing to even think about that, isn't it? And whatever your situation is, what if there was absolutely no hope? I'm telling you, it'd be hard to sleep like that if there was no hope. And so they had gotten discouraged. And it says all hope that we should be saved was then taken. They were beginning to resign to defeat. And that's exactly where the enemy wants you to be. He wants you to devote your focus from the God of the storm to the gales of the storm. But I'm going to tell you something. One of my points last week was when I preached the introduction to this thing was faith will make you fight. I don't know about you, but when the devil says you can't, when the devil says it ain't going to happen, when the devil says this is the end all be all, I'm going to tell you what it does to me. It makes me want to say, that ain't what thus saith the Lord. It makes me want to stand up and fight just a little bit and say, no, you're not taking me down with your lies. You're not going to do that. So tonight, I'm calling on us. I don't think there's ever been a time in history, I know there hadn't been in my lifetime, when we needed to have faith more than we need to have it right now. Let me tell you something tonight. If you don't keep your faith, they're going to tell us we can't come to church anymore. Paul was on his way. I might as well just go ahead and let this go. I've been thinking about it all day anyway. Paul was on his way to stand before the court to decide if it was okay if he continued to preach Jesus. Amen? That's the bottom line. You say, but that's not the situation here. There's other factors in play. I don't know what excuse they come up with back. I wasn't there. Fox News wasn't there. CNN didn't cover that. And if they did, I don't know that I'd believe it. But what I can tell you tonight was when they said, you can't preach Jesus anymore, he said, I don't believe I'm going to let you tell me what to do. And I don't think if we fool around and don't keep the faith, son, they're going to be telling us one day when we can serve God or not. They're going to be, this is all about them controlling us. I want to be out of control. Amen. Don't tell me I can't come and preach on Jesus. He's the only hope we got.
Amen.
Golly, I didn't mean to get off on all that tonight. But anyway, I do have to hurry. Not only the ferociousness of the storm, we're in a bad storm right now. Some of you are probably in storms other than that storm. You might be like Paul. He was in a storm before the storm hit. But now he's really in a storm. But then, secondly, the fervency of prayer. Let me show you something real quick. Well, before I get to that, let me provide you a little context here. To fully appreciate the faith that Paul had, the belief in God, the absolute unadulterated trust. Boy, I know we're human. This is easy preaching. Sometimes it's hard living. But this is Hebrews chapter, I believe it's Hebrews 11. I can't remember for sure. But at any rate, it says, without faith, it's impossible to please Him. Talking about God. He requires faith. We must believe. We must have faith. But let me give you, to fully appreciate the faith of Paul, you got to understand the adverse conditions that they faced. Look, the storm was so intense that they had no control over the ship. The captain had already made the decision to just let the ship go wherever the wind took it. I mean, it was that much out of control. He had done abandoned it. Sound like some of our leaders today, just abandoned. Just go wherever it took it. Their path was being dictated by the storm. Boy, we don't ever want to be there, do we? You don't want your path being dictated by the storm. You want your path being dictated by the God of the storm.
Amen.
Trying to survive, throwing things overboard. I can imagine they had their buckets in their hand, 274 of them. There's 275 on the boat. But 274 of them had their buckets in their hand, and they had done throw things overboard. They was throwing water as quick as they could try to get it out. And I imagine John looked over at Fred and said, where's Paul? Why ain't Paul helping us? Where's Paul at during all of this? I can imagine Jim looked over at Jason and said, have you seen Paul lately? No, I ain't seen him, man. Don't worry about Paul. Just keep throwing water out. Just keep getting rid of it. Don't worry about him. He'll show up in a little bit. And you know what? They were right. He showed up in a little bit. In verse number, let's see where we're at here. In verse number 21, look when Paul shows up in verse number 21. But after long abstinence, not absence, abstinence. Now that word, and we'll get to that here in just a second, in its context, this is commitment. But in verse number 21 it says, but after long abstinence. That word abstinence leads you to the thought process of fasting. It means doing without. After long abstinence, not absence, read on that. It kind of leads you to believe that maybe Paul was in the bottom of the ship. Now, fasting's a forgotten doctrine. I told you I was going to preach some old stuff in this because we've got to get faith again. Fasting lets God know how serious you are about whatever it is you're praying about. And we're going to talk about prayer here for just a minute. But it's the forgotten doctrine. You know, the old saints of God, they'd pray. And sometimes they'd do without a cheeseburger. I don't want to have to resort to that. Me loves, I gladly pay you Thursday for a cheeseburger today, all right? Y'all remember Wimpy? Surely you do, right? On Popeye? I gladly. I don't want to resort, but I'm going to tell you something. If it'll move the hand of God today, and fasting does, it's biblical doctrine today, we just need to return to the place where we get serious enough about our prayer life that we can do without sometimes, and we'll fast and say, God, I'm doing without this. It don't necessarily have to be food. It can be other thing. I'm fasting, God. This is how serious I am about wanting to beat this storm. I'm wanting to make it through this thing. I'm sorry. Sometimes I get worried about us that we don't have the amount of faith. Prayer, we use prayer as a last resort when it should be our first line of defense. I often say it aggravates me to hear people say, well, all we can do is pray. Is that all you can do? Sounds like a pretty powerful thing to me. But you know, when you get to that point, you're probably at the right place. I don't know about you, but it seems like we like to struggle with things, and I'm world's worst. Men, they don't want to read the directions. We don't want to do that. We don't want to stop and ask for directions to nowhere. We got navigational systems. We won't have to do that anymore. It's helping our manhood. But we don't want to do that. And I'm the world's worst. I got lots of, when it comes to doing something or fixing something, I want to do it myself. I want to fix that thing myself or whatever. Yesterday, I ordered, we got a little doggy door on the back of the house, and it's got this little flap that flops. And the dog goes out, got a little old dog named Gigi. And she can flop out and flop in as she wants to. We lock her up in the laundry room to keep her from making a mess in the house. And that thing, where her old dirty nose, you know, she's still a dog. All right? She's a good little old dog, but she's still a dog. And her little old dirty nose, where she's been out rooting around trying to dig up moles and everything else, that little old dirty nose has hit that flap enough that it put a black spot. That nasty looking, and I've been looking at it for a long time thinking, boy, that's nasty. You know, I figured eventually she'd get to where she might push it open with her paw and sneak through instead of trying. But at any rate, I been looked at that thing and I thought, you know what, I'm on. I remember a long time, I mean, I've had that thing for years, and I wrote on a piece of paper, I anticipated the problem. I wrote down on a piece of paper the part number of that replacement pet flap. And I thought, one of these days I'll have to order that. So sure enough, I dug and I dug and I dug in the house, and I come up with that little yellow piece of paper that had the replacement pet flap part number on it. So I Googled it, and I found where I bought it on Chewy.com. All right, that's where they got them things at. Got it on Chewy.com. They shipped that thing to the house, and it's been laying on the floor for about a month now. And finally the other day, I said, I'm going to put that thing on. It's just a flap. It ought to be the simplest thing in the whole wide world. It really should be. And so I got this little, it's a piece of plastic that big. It's got a magnet on the bottom, and it connects with the other magnet that's stationary to hold the door so water can't come in and bugs and things you don't want in the house. But when it flops down, it catches on that magnet. And you'd think it'd just be four screws right there, and you'd just take them four screws out, or two, or however many, and put them others back, and you'd be done. But no, it's made in China. Made in Wuhan. And that little thing, it had this, a little plastic piece across the back. And the flap, you had to hold the flap to the plastic piece, get it behind another plastic piece, which was behind the door. Now, how in the world are you going to get... I didn't have enough hands. But you know what I did for an hour? I fought that thing with my whole being. I did. I said, you know what? There's no way I'm letting this thing beat me. And then it started getting cloudy, and I heard it thunder, and I thought, oh, Lord, I done got the other flap off now. And ain't no just putting that oven back on, because it goes on the same way this one goes on. Ain't no just... I thought, Lord, I'm going to have to go get the duct tape. I'm going to have to do something. I'm going to flood the house. Carlene's going to be mad. I ain't going to get no dinner for a month if she comes home and the house is flooded because I can't. But finally, I struggled with that thing, and I finally come to the end of myself. I said, you know what, self? If you had four hands, you could do this. One, two. I gave up. I got on the phone. I called my brother. I seen his truck sitting over in the yard. I called my brother. I woke him up. I said, brother, what are you doing right now? He said, oh, just being lazy. I said, can you come over here and help me put this pet flap on this dog? He said, pet flap? I said, yeah. I said, can you come help me? And you know what? He come over there, and we had it on in less than a minute and a half. We had that thing on. Let me tell you something about prayer. When you get to that place, when you can't handle it by yourself, why don't you just, you got to give in. And if you'll just call on him, he's a good God today. He's all on your side. He's ever been on your side. You can trust him to help you. You can trust him. That he wants to be. I ain't saying you ain't going to never. In fact, I'm saying the opposite. You're going to go through trials. You're going to go through hard times. You're going to go through things that aren't fair. Life ain't always going to be fair. You're not always going to get the promotion at work. In fact, as a Christian, you're probably going to be persecuted when you think it's completely unfair. That's probably going to happen. But I'm glad he didn't leave us down here on this earth all by ourselves with no help and no hope in the world. You can call on him tonight, brother, and he'll help you get that thing fixed, whatever it is that you're going through tonight. He'll help you. The fervency of prayer. James 5:16 says, the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. And I believe that today. I believe that if you'll get down on your knee. Jesus said men ought always to pray and not to faint. He's saying, man, I mean, this is Jesus saying that, all right? Men ought always pray, not to faint. The psalmist said, evening, morning, and at noon will I pray and cry aloud, and the Lord might. Or the Lord maybe. No. He said, and the Lord shall hear my voice. I'm telling you, you got help today. You can trust him if you'll just believe again. He's still able to do all the things that you hear the old saints tell about. He's still able. I got to be done here. Number three is the faithfulness of the Lord. Verse number 23 and 24, real quick like. For there stood by me... This is Paul said, for there stood by me this night the angel of God, whose I am and whom I serve. Verse number 23, as Charles calls it, verse number 23a, the first part, I learned that from you, tells us a little bit about God's presence. Have you ever been in that hard place? I mean, that dark night might be that you'd lost your job. Might be you just found out you had some medical issues or somebody you love had medical issues. Could be any number of things. But you've been in that place. And if you've never, let me just say this, if you've never felt I like a Jesus I can feel. If you've never felt the presence of God, I don't even know how to describe it. I just know it's real. I just know when your heart's broke. And it's the middle of the night. And the devil ain't got his arm around you telling him it's going to be okay, I love you, it's going to be... No, it ain't. And you say, God, I don't know how I'm going to do this. And it's just like, I don't know, it's like being cold and just a big warm blanket coming on you. I don't know how to describe it. Can somebody help me with words? It's just his presence. It's that comforter. Not the one you get over at Walmart for $39.95, and it's made in China too. A real one gonna cost you more than that. But it's the presence. You can feel him in the church. Most times of America. Ain't you thankful today we can feel him most every time in here? You know why? Because there's some praying people. There's some people that believe God. There's some people that trust him. But if you've never felt the presence of God, when you're in some of your dark times, if you'll just call on him, he'll come to where you are. And it'll be real. It's so real. God's presence. Verse number 23, for there stood me by me this night, the angel of God. And then there's God's possession. Whose I am and whom I serve. You ain't the average Joe tonight. Ain't you glad to know that? You're God's possession. The scripture says, for ye are bought. I know that's that'll be racist for long, I'm sure, but ye are bought with a price. Paul said, I'm his slave. He owns me, and he said it with great pride in his heart. I can't think of anybody I'd rather have to master over me, can you? That's why you accept him. You can't just accept him as Savior. He's Lord, too. Amen. And I'm so glad tonight. I'm God's possession. I'm one of the king's kids tonight. When the devil comes knocking, I got somebody to answer the door for me, man. I'm telling you tonight, we are not average. We belong to him tonight. Our Father is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's the highest among the high tonight. We're his possession tonight. Whose I am and whom I serve. Verse number 24, I got to hurry up. I got to close. Verse number 24, saying, fear not, Paul. Thou must be brought before Caesar. And lo, God hath given thee all them that sail with thee. Ain't it good to have friends in high places? Yeah. 274 other men lived because Paul was God's. 207, I can't guarantee it, but I imagine it to be so. If Paul wouldn't have been on that ship, it'd have probably been 274 bodies laying on whatever ocean or sea they was in. And a ship that only found broken boards and pieces of. That's all they'd have found of it. But God's man was on that ship. And he was going to Rome to tell Caesar the same story that he told Felix about when he was on the Damascus Road that day. And there was a light shined on him, and it was Jesus. And he was going to tell Caesar that same story, and God said, you know what, you're going to make it. I'm going to get you to Rome. You're going to Rome. What I'm telling you tonight is God does still provide. He's going to get you what you need tonight. He loves you. I ain't saying you'll never, every time you get sick, he'll heal you. One of these days you're going to get sick and you're going to die. Because that's what the Bible says. I've seen a newspaper clipping 25 years ago in a Chattanooga, Tennessee newspaper said, healing service canceled, healer dies. Yeah, a real newspaper clip. I had great joy, preached many times out of that. I wasn't glad that he died, but it just proves a point. Sometimes God just wants to take you on. He got better things for me and you. We got hope outside of this world. I got a quick story. He provides. God still provides. How many people believe he still provides? He's done it too many times for me. I got to tell this one quickly. I got to get y'all out of here. 8:09. I'm a minute later than my normal. A little fellow used to go to church with me down in Sugar Valley. His name was Lloyd. It was either Greason or Grant. I'm having a hard time recalling his name right now. He's a faithful man. He's kind of a quiet man. He didn't say a lot. I mean, he came faithfully. He's there every Sunday morning, every Sunday night. Came a lot on Wednesday nights. Faithful guy. But he come up missing for a few weeks, and I called him. I finally got his phone number and talked to him. It was back before everybody had, every single person, even three-year-olds, had a cell phone. It was back before that. But anyway, I got a hold of him. He said, well, I was about to call you anyway. I was hoping maybe you could go to the doctor with me tomorrow. And I said, okay, I think I can do that, Lloyd. So we went to the, I said, where you want me to meet and where we going and all that stuff. He said, well, I done been, and they told me it didn't look real good, but they run some tests, and now they've called me back down there, and I'm afraid I'm going to hear bad news, and I'd just really like for somebody to be with me. I said, Lord, let me call work. I'll go with you. We took off and rode down to Rome to the hospital. We got down there, and sure enough, they had bad news. They got the x-rays out, showed them to him. And this wasn't, I mean, even the untrained eye could clearly see. He had a couple of big old knots in his lung and one somewhere else down in here toward his side. I can remember that image in my mind. I thought, goodness, man, don't look good. So they told him they was going do a biopsy on him, and they did that, and wound up coming back, it was really cancer. And old Lloyd, I'm telling you, he wasn't one of these loud front swing from the chandeliers, snake handling. He's just a man that went about his faith in good standing, and he believed God. So he called me up not too long after that. He said, Brother David, I want you to go back to the doctor. Well, this is about a month later or so. They'd done told him he had it, and they were going. He said, they're going to schedule my surgery today. And I'd really like somebody to be with me. And I said, no, I understand, man. I know it's hard, Lloyd. He said, well, no, that ain't it. He said, I want you to meet me down. We had a rock altar behind Sugar Valley Church, and it's probably still there. We had a rock altar, a cross with a bunch of rocks stacked up around it. There's been a lot of prayers answered on that rock altar. He said, I want you to meet me at the rock altar first. The reason I want you to go with me to the hospital is so you can hear them say it ain't there no more. And I thought, well, I'll humor him. Now again, oh, you have little faith. I thought, I'll humor him. So I met him. I said, what time you got to be down there? He said, well, I got to be down there at 10 o'clock, so we need to meet around 8:30, 8:45 down to Rock Alder. I said, I'll be there. So we went down, and we went back there, knelt down and prayed, and I heard, oh, Lord, he didn't say a whole lot. He just said, God, you know what I had last time I made this trip? When I get down there this time, I don't believe it's time for me to go. He said, when I get down there this time, I want it to be gone. In Jesus' name, amen. I mean, I didn't even get through the whole holy heavenly Father thou art. I didn't get through all that. He done got it done. He said, all right, let's go. We got in his vehicle. Mine wasn't worth driving. Didn't know if it'd make it down there or not. We went down there, and they were going to do one final. I guess it's standard procedure. They were going to do one final x-ray before they scheduled his surgery or whatever. And all the way down there, man, he talked. I didn't want to talk about his condition. He didn't want to talk about it. He wanted to talk about the weather, what he's having for dinner that night, and where he's going on vacation in the fall. That's what he wanted to talk about. So I got the clue, and I just talked to him about that stuff. When we got in the parking lot, he said, we're going to go in here, and they're going to x-ray me, and it ain't going to be there, I'm telling you. And I said, all right, brother, I'm going to believe with you. And we went in there, and this is honest God's truth. The doctor came back out. And I was sitting there with Lloyd. And the doctor come back out, shaking his head, come back in his little room. And he said, never seen anything like it. And I said, what's going on? He had the little x-rays with him. He stuck them around there. And I'm telling you, the untrained eye that could see that it was there could also see that it wasn't there anymore. And sure as the world, it was gone. And I was, you know, back in, I was wide open, Charles. I mean, I cut loose to shouting in the doctor's office. I was, hallelujah, glory. I mean, I was having me a spell. And old Lloyd looked at me and said, you act like you're surprised. And I thought to myself, you know what? He said, if you've been here before, act like it. That's what he said. I've never seen such faith in all my... What I'm asking us to do tonight, and I know it's hard. You can't just turn it on and turn it off like a switch. You got to build that stuff. But can't we just trust God? Can I get you to trust? You can trust him about everything. You can trust him about that air conditioner in your truck. I'm going to try it. I'm going to pray. God's probably going to tell me to go see Julio or whoever you told me about, Charles, that fixes yours. But can I get you to believe? We have people of great faith in here. Claire's one of those great faith people that we have in here tonight. She prays. She believes. She prays about everything. That's why I'm preaching. I believe God for a few weeks here. If we can just get our faith restored, we can whoop this thing that's going on in our country. We can whoop our own personal situations. God, how many folks believe God still on the throne? I believe that. With my whole soul, I believe it. Oh, sorry, Mark. Didn't mean to mess up your recording there. I believe that with my whole soul. I believe he's still on the throne. Don't mean you don't fight. Don't mean you don't take the advice of medical professionals. It just means this. God is bigger than all of that. Bigger than all of that. Can we pray real quick? Can we do that? Father, we thank you tonight for the grand privilege of being in your house. And we thank you, God, that you can still be trusted. You're still our provider. You still show up when our heart's broke. You still love us when nobody else loves us. And we're so thankful for that tonight. God, we pray if there's one person in this building that's letting fear just overrun them, we pray, God, you'll replace it tonight with faith. Help us to believe you again, God. Help me, help David Green to trust you more and more every day that goes by. And God, we're going to love you and we're going to thank you for all you do in this place. Help them through the storms, God. We know you will. In Jesus' name, amen.